So, like any good Wagner, I forgot the obituary at home. I have it on my dad's iPhone, though, so he would love this that I'm reading it off the iPhone. Oh, man, it's going to be like this the whole time, so just settle in. Douglas Bruce Wagner, age 61, formerly of Garden City, died Wednesday, July 6, 2011, at the Olathe Medical Center in Olathe, Kansas. He was born May 8, 1950, in Garden City, Kansas. The son of Louis Robert, real name was Louis, but we like to call him Louis or Grandpa, and Ruthella Streeter Wagner. I thought about telling him your real name, Grandma, but I decided not to. She'd have punched me. Doug grew up in Garden City and graduated from Garden City High School and from Garden City Community College. A resident of Gardner since Gardner, Kansas, since 2007, he had been a small business sales associate for AT&T in Kansas City, Missouri. And can I add a dang good one? On June 19th, 1971, he married Janice Lynn Crockett in Garden City, Kansas. She survives. Other survivors include two sons, Douglas Chip Wagner II of Spring Hill, Kansas, Kent Wagner, the better-looking one of Andover, Kansas. He would have loved that. You know he would have. One daughter, Catherine Katie Wagner of Pittsburgh, Kansas. His mother, Ruthella Wagner of Garden City, Kansas. One brother, Roger Wagner of Muskogee, Oklahoma. One sister, Lena Christensen of Garden City, Kansas. And six grandchildren. He was preceded in death by his father, a son Peter, and a brother Louis R. Wagner III. Yeah, we're gonna watch a video now, a montage that my brother put together, my dad and our family. So.
Viva Las Vegas. Viva, viva Las Vegas.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you.
How's the giraffe go? Put your hands down. How's the giraffe go? How's a bear go? Okay. Put your hands down. How does a cow go? How's a duck go? How's a dog go?
Woof, woof.
And how's a lion go? Really loud, really loud. How's a lion go?
Rah.
Get your hands out of your mouth. How's a lion go?
Rah.
No, loud. Rawr! Like that.
Rah.
I see trees. What a wonderful.
Remember to understand that one. In a moment, my Aunt Lena and Uncle Roger are going to come up and share a few thoughts and memories, and then my brother Chip and his daughter Chloe are going to come up and share a few things. Can I just say my dad would have thought it was really funny that we played a song that talked about getting high in church, so come on up, Lena and Roger.
Our brother Doug was the best and most loving husband to his lovely bride, the best father, grandpa, son, and brother, brother-in-law, uncle, and friend that there ever was.
He taught us through our parents' teaching to always have faith and to work hard at doing our best. He truly believed that good thoughts and that good things would happen to you. He also taught us to help everyone, regardless of their opinions of anything else. Doug never knew a stranger and was a friend to everyone, even in elevators, which I find a little awkward, but he would talk with everyone. He felt it was bad manners to not talk with someone, so he had conversations with people in elevator. And if it was family in the elevator only, he'd push all the buttons so we had more time to talk. People that said that Doug and us, the family, could clear a waiting room in just a few minutes with all of our nonsense, because we are kind of goofy at times.
Doug gave with his heart to whatever the task was at hand, whether it was family, church, or United Way. Now, many of you know our brother Doug always said he was special, and he was. You also probably know there was no one who loved a good joke or to sing a song more than Doug, and he thought he sang well.
You could tell that.
Our family sang of Alice's restaurant, pickles and motorcycles, and feet that were too big.
For some of you that don't know Feet, that was a Fats Waller song.
That our father loved.
Yeah. Doug was also famous. When we were kids, Doug would sign his name on slips of paper, Douglas B. Wagner, Esquire. He would tell us to keep hold of that paper because someday it would be worth a lot of money. I wish we had some of those today. The three boys in our family attended Lincoln School, and Doug was even famous then. In those days, you could buy little cereal boxes and where you could kind of cut it out and then open the package inside and pour your milk right in and eat it. Well, he took some of those empty boxes to school and sold them as pencil holders. So he's been in sales. He'd been in sales his whole life. It gets better. He later sold his box business in trade for a robot. But Mom made him undo that particular transaction and give it back. I'm embarrassed about this one, but Doug was one of the first ones with help to dye the polar bears at the zoo. That's strange, but okay. One kind of got sort of muddly green, and one was half green and half white. That one's beautiful. He was also one of the first ones to put an undergarment on the Statue of Liberty out in front of the courthouse.
We bless you all for coming today to help us celebrate our brother's life. We're sure of several things at this point. The first is that Doug dances with the angels. The second is that our father, our brother Lou, Doug's son Peter, and all the others who have gone before rejoice that Doug has eternal life through Jesus the Christ with them and someday with us. Amen. The third is that if heaven did not have a karaoke lounge before, we're sure that they have one now. And the heavens ring with singing. I talked to Doug on July 6th, Allison's birthday. What a privilege for her. The day he died. And he wanted me to know that he was at peace and he felt wonderful. He made these statements several times and said he would call Mom and Roger later that day to tell them that he was at peace. Doug told me that whatever happened, he would be fine. He then said he loved me, and I said I loved him. This conversation took place before Doug took a turn for the worse. But I'm here to tell you that Doug was at peace. And he wants you to find peace in this celebration of his life.
In closing, we would ask that you not say goodbye to Doug, but simply, we'll see you later. And
see you later, Doug. Love you.
The same thing that he said at our father's funeral. Hug someone as you leave.
Make their day better.
My grandpa was a thoughtful man who loved his family and friends. He was full of joy and a great man. He gave me lots of hugs and lots of laughs. But most of all, he loved us so much, and even though we miss him, but he's in a better place now, then that place is heaven where all Christians go.
You know, you think about what to say at your
dad's funeral, and so we were driving into town, and you know, as kids, we used to come here every year. This was our family vacation, is come see Grandma and Grandpa. And, Dad would always take us to the Garden City, world's largest free municipal concrete swimming pool. And we went there yesterday and just kind of let the kids play. You know, you look at the lifeguard, I was just going through all kinds of thoughts about Dad playing with us in the pool and telling us about how he swam across the pool. And you look at the lifeguards, and they're, and no offense if anybody's a lifeguard, but they're just kind of sitting around, you know, they're not really doing anything. They're just kind of sitting there all day long and kind of hanging out, and they're really there in case somebody starts drowning. I mean, they're really just there, I guess, to kind of look cool until somebody starts drowning, and then they jump in and they go and save that person. And you know, that really is a metaphor for my dad's life. He, a lot of times it just seemed like he's just sitting around. But you know, but when there was trouble in people's lives, like I think about in my own life and my family's life, and I look around and my dad, my mom and dad were always right there. They were always there to jump in into people's lives and make a difference and be there for them. And I'm very thankful that the last week of my dad's life, he went in for a pretty routine minor surgery, and he'd had some stuff going on before that, and it became apparent that he had a lot more, he had heart problems and other things that became apparent very quickly after that. And I'm so thankful that I got to be there for that last week. It was at the hospital that I work at. I got to take my lunch break and go down and see him. You know, in the last minutes, last couple of hours, my mom, I'd gone to see my dad over lunch, and I went home, and my mom sent me a text message saying, "I need you here." And I came up, and my dad was in intensive care, and it was pretty, pretty frightening. And you could tell he was in turmoil. I mean, there was doctors and nurses, and I got to, one of the guys in charge of that floor, Joey, he said, "You can go in." And so I went in, and I put my hands on Dad, and he grabbed my hand, and I could feel he was squeezing my hand. And so I just went down to his ear, and I said, "Dad, I love you, and I'm sorry I haven't always been the best son, and you're going to be with Jesus now, and I'm going to pray for you." And I got to pray with my dad. And I stood there. I guess he wasn't standing, but I stood there for a while with him and just silently prayed. And then I told him, "I'm going to go be with Mom now and take care of Mom." And I think about all, I wasn't always, I don't know that I'm a great kid now, but there was a lot of years that I was not, certainly not the ideal son. And a few times Dad told me to get out of the house, and whether joking or serious, and he always, "Get out of here." And when he was holding my hand, I said, "I'm going to go see Mom now," he threw my hand out like that. And then it was a peace after that, and I just, you know, we all go through this at times in our lives, and I've never been more at peace and confident that someone I love is in heaven and rejoicing, and there's angels and God, and just my Father's in heaven today. Yeah. I'm just so thankful for the life that he led and that I got to be part of that. I was looking in the mirror today, and I'll finish up here, so I don't want to be out here too long, but I'm wearing my dad's tie. He always had really nice ties, which he hardly ever wore the last couple of years, but I was putting on my tie, and I was thinking, I think it was probably maybe Grandpa Wagner's funeral, or my great-grandpa Wagner's funeral, his dad, and getting ready in front of the mirror with Dad, and, you know, most parents would be like, you're such a good-looking kid, or I'm so proud of you, and he'd always say, you know, I'm looking in the mirror, and I can't figure it out. I'm like, I'm waiting for the compliment. He says, how you got such a good-looking dad? Yeah. So, I will think of my dad every time I look in the mirror, because Lord knows that was one of his favorite places to be. He loved sitting there. Probably, he probably is the only guy I know that spent more time in front of the mirror than his wife did. So with that, I'll go ahead and turn it over. God bless you all for being here too.
When you're the pastor in the family, you get stuck preaching the sermon. So, and praying at meals. I always joked with my dad that I'd pray really long prayers so that somebody would finally go, let's quit asking Kent to pray. So I normally don't do this, but I'm going to read my dad's sermon because I'm not sure I'm going to make it through very well. So bear with me. If my dad were here today, I can just about guarantee that before the service, he would have pulled you aside and made a joke about how he wrote the sermon. He would have paused and, while laughing at the impending joke, said, as long as it's good. But for the first time in my entire ministry career, he would have been telling the truth. This is a sermon that has been 61 years in the making. It is a sermon that has experienced the joy of hearing your first child's cry as he came into the world, and having your first laugh with that child as you watch him pee on the unsuspecting nurse. My dad loved to tell that story about Chip. It's a sermon that grieved through the loss of a child at birth and rejoiced at seeing his only daughter come into the world. My sister Katie, when she was little, used to puff out her bottom lip and quiver it a little bit. And with just the right look on her face, she could get my dad to do anything she wanted. He called it the Snoopy face or Snoopy look. Snoopy look. And he absolutely loved you, Katie. And he loved that you had him wrapped around his finger because he loved you. This is a sermon that has seen long years of financial struggle, 40 years of wonderful, real, in-the-moment love with his bride, my mother, Janice, and the longest stream of the funniest stories ever told over and over and over again. It's a sermon of greater magnitude than I have the capacity to preach, and one of which I have the honor to share while embracing the remorse of having to do so. This is a sermon of a son, a brother, a father, a husband, a papa, a salesman, and a friend. It's my privilege to preach this sermon and have the honor of trying to capture moments of my father, my daddy, and share them with you. I will miss him so dearly. Knowing my dad was to know his stories. He was not the sort of guy who told tons of corny jokes, although he could knock those out of the park if he had to. I know he's the kind of man who knew how to spend life in a way that everything was funny and everyday mundane events became the sparks of life. It was wonderful to grow up with such a storyteller for a dad, We were regularly regaled with stories of uncles who threw brothers through walls, although I seem to be the only one who remembers that story. I don't know. You remember? Thank you, Chip. All right. Brothers who cheated at board games and made those rules are still the stuff of legend in the Wagner household. My dad would always laugh as he told the story. Lena kind of filled me in on the details, but he told Lena that my grandpa had asked them to check and make sure the lawnmower was still running. And so he took her out there and said, "You need to hold the spark plug and this wire here." He yanked on the cord. Oh, man, he loved to tell that story, man. I do not think it ended well. But Lena, he loved to get you going. He did. We heard stories of roller skates being turned into skateboards, trips to California, cotton balls dipped in chocolate and served up as April Fool's jokes, and many, many more. He loved it. Who was the kid? He ate all of them. And my dad thought it was so funny. I can go make you more if you want. My dad, he could captivate a room. And even if you'd heard his stories a million times, he told them like it was his first, and he made you laugh all the same. Every year for my birthday, my dad would call, and he'd say, "Have I ever told you about when you were born?" Yes. He'd go on to tell me how he was in the waiting room with all the other dads, and you know, he's joking and just having a blast with them. And some nurse comes storming through the doors and says, "Which one of you is Wagner?" And he said, "I am." And she said, "Get back here, Wagner." He said, "Yes, ma'am." You know, he was always polite. He went back in the room, and she said, "Get dressed, Wagner." And my mom was in the middle of giving birth to me. And I'm certain that the next part was his favorite, because he would get a big smile on his face, and he'd start chuckling. And he'd say, "I came into the delivery room, and your mother was in the middle of labor. The nurse told me, get over here." So I start doing the breathing, and he'd always be like, yeah. He said the nurse looked at me and said, "You didn't practice, did you?" And he said, "No, ma'am." And she said, "Get out of the way, Wagner." He knew it drove me crazy to hear that story year after year. And now I don't think my birthday will ever be the same. I loved it when it got to the end. Because he always thought he was so funny. He was. He'd die laughing. And he'd tell me in complete sincerity how much he loved me and how proud he was of me as a son. One of the things I'm most thankful for, is that my dad never ended a conversation without telling us how much he loved us and how proud of us he was. I love that story because somehow it encapsulates the essence of my dad. In the most serious of situations, he could bring levity. He was full of life, vibrant, positive, and yet able to capitalize on crucial moments and say the right things to let you know everything would be all right. Grandma, I'm so sorry for your loss. You were all I could think of when I was driving up. I know that everything that is in my dad has passed from you and Grandpa. And I want you to know how deeply I feel for you and how grateful I am for you. We all love you so much. My dad was so much more than just a father. He was a tremendous salesman and an entertainer, and most of all, a loving husband. While my dad was in the hospital before everything failed, he had crashed and things were really starting to go downhill. My mom said that when he came to, the nurse asked him, "Do you know where you are?" And he said, "I'm here with you." That was my dad. He finally told him he was in the hospital. And they pointed to my mom and they said, "Do you know who this is?" My dad looked over at my mother and he said, "That's Janet. That's my bride." People would hear my dad call my mom his bride and be surprised that they had been married for 40 years. They just celebrated their 40th anniversary. It's fitting to me that those words, "That's my bride," were the last words he said to my mom. He's really going to be missed. Those last few hours before my dad passed from this world to the next, my sister Katie and I were standing by his bedside talking about how we didn't know what to say to him. He'd been chemically sedated and paralyzed and couldn't talk back to us, but we could talk to him, and his eyes were open, and I know he saw us. We told him we loved him and how great of a dad he was. We struggled to find words, but my dad, he would have known exactly what to say. He was fantastic in those moments. He could bring life into lifeless rooms. He could put a smile on the most dapper of faces. He could speak and inspire in the most desperate of moments. But I don't want you to get the wrong picture about my dad. It would be a disservice to my father to have you think that his sermon was a clear, strong note cutting through the entirety of his life. In fact, I believe he was anything but that. His story is a message much stronger than one of perfection and sainthood. My father's story is one of failure, of hurt and pain and loss, and still rising again. I told my wife, Jenny, that I don't really have a whole lot of memories from my childhood with my dad. I remember dancing to the Beach Boys, on the, you know, surfing on the couch, and he loved that. Man, he would just die laughing when we were doing that. I remember getting yelled at for bringing 10 dogs home. I didn't tell anybody they were there. And my parents were sleeping, and they heard, "Roo!" There were 10 dogs in the backyard. I remember him being stressed and worried. I know now as a man how much he suffered wanting to provide for us, fighting an uphill battle to do so. He was a man in the midst of incredible tension. I found my dad's Bible at my parents' house. It was right out in the open. I remember when my dad got this Bible in 1989, I remember years of watching this Bible sit on shelves and looking good as the day he got it. For years, my dad struggled with anger and achievement. But in the last 10 to 15 years, something changed about my dad. He was always a Christian, but I believe in the last decade or so, he became a Christ follower. As I looked through my dad's Bible, I saw page after page of notes in his handwriting and scriptures underlined and marked. I saw the wear and tear that had been placed on this tome. I read in Proverbs, Mom, where Dad underlined chapter 12, verse 4, "A wife of noble character is her husband's crown." And next to it, his sprawling, goofy handwriting, it simply said, "That's Janice. You were his crown. Mom, Dad loved you so much. I know things are not always easy for the two of you, but in all the years I knew him, he never once said a negative thing about you. He only spoke of his love for you, his bride. I know it would have tore him up to know he had left you, because he loved you like crazy." See, my dad's life was not a song of one note piercing through this world in clarity and devotion of quality. His song had so much more life to it. His was one of a low, rumbling note that rose and climbed, ever crescendoing, beckoning all to the life he had found. I'm certain of one thing my dad would have wanted to say to all of you, because he spoke of it often to me and actually requested that I say it to you on this day. What I'm about to tell you is the most real thing to my father. My dad would say to you, "The most important thing in this life is a relationship with Jesus Christ." I know preachers say this kind of thing all the time, but remember, this is not my sermon. This is my dad, Doug, the salesman who could sell you the proverbial ketchup popsicle even if you had your white gloves on. This is my dad, your brother-in-law, the one who invited you in and made you laugh and cry. This is my dad, the uncle, who joked with you and clowned with you, and he really loved you guys like you were his own. This is my dad, your brother, the one who wept with you at the loss of your father. This is my dad, the one who showed you what it looks like to be a husband and love his bride with everything you got. This is my dad. And he wanted more than anything for each of you to know the joy and peace he had found in Christ. You know, when I was a child, some of you guys may remember this. I cut my knee open really badly. It was deep. It was like a quarter of an inch from paralyzing me from the knee down. When I got the call this week that my dad had turned for the worse. I was at a church camp as the speaker, and my dad was always, he just made such good sermon illustrations. He was all the time the topic of my sermon illustrations, and I was going to tell this story as the main point of my sermon, and I think it's fitting that I kind of finish it with it. I had been playing basketball at a friend named Jeremy's house, and I was awesome at basketball, and I shot, and I missed. It's the height, you know, I really did. And the ball had rolled out on the grass, and I jumped on it. We still don't know what did it, but something cut through my knee. I mean, just straight through. And I remember it's just all kind of whirlwind, but my mom came and picked me up, and I was in our old station wagon, and I remember my leg hanging out the door with blood dripping down my pant leg, waiting for my dad to get home. I can still see his face, big mustache. Guess that's what you did in the 80s. And and I remember going to the medical clinic. And I don't ever remember my parents worrying about money, but I know because we were, if anything, we were poor at the time. And I know they had to have been so worried about money. I remember going in and doctors and nurses going crazy and them putting me on this bed and them telling me they're going to have to give shots in my knee, like inside the wound, and stitch the inside up and stitch the outside up. I can remember sitting there holding my dad's hand, and he always made a joke about me squeezing the blood out of his hand. I mean, I was squeezing as tight as I could, man. I was holding on for life. And I remember my dad so clearly, tears pouring out of his eyes, saying, "Son, if I wish I could take your place." And I cut through my own tears and I said, "So do I." He would laugh and laugh and kind of cry. But when he told me that story, and he would say to me that he really did wish more than anything that he could have taken my place. I am so torn up over the loss of my father. But I want you to know this. My dad was the kind of man who would want this moment to count for more than just celebrations tainted by grief and sorrow. My dad would want each of you to know that God intended this life to count for something more than money, work, and friends, and fun. He enjoyed all those things, don't get me wrong. But he loved God and his family. I believe that my dad would want his passing to be the catalyst for you to know God. He would want to hold your hand with tears in his eyes and a choked voice say, "I would give myself for you." My dad would want you to ask Jesus to be your Lord and the boss of your life. He would want you to become a Christ follower so you could know the peace and joy he knew and have your song rise like his. My dad's Bible today is worn and destroyed because my dad knew Jesus. Today we mourn because God did not create humanity for death. I thought of this when my grandpa Wagner passed away. God didn't create us to die. It was sin that caused us to die. He created us to live forever. We mourn because the unthinkable has happened. Creation has turned on itself through sin and destroyed what ought not be destroyed. But today, with somber hearts, we rejoice that my father, my dad, my daddy, and my children's papa knew Jesus intimately and had entered into eternal life, and he did it well. I'd like to read a passage from 1 Corinthians 15:51 through 57 out of the Message version. But let me tell you something wonderful, a mystery I'll probably never fully understand. We're not all going to die. But we're all going to be changed. You hear a blast to end all blasts from a trumpet. And in that time, you look up and blink your eyes. It's over. On signal from the trumpet from heaven, the dead will be up and out of their graves. Looking good. Beyond the reach of death, never to die again. At the same moment and in the same way, we'll all be changed. In the resurrection scheme of things, this has to happen. Everything perishable taken off the shelves and replaced by the imperishable. This mortal replaced by the immortal. Then the saying will come true. death swallowed by triumphant life. Who got the last word, O death? O death, who's afraid of you now? It was sin that made death so frightening, and law code guilt that gave sin its leverage, its destructive power. But now, in a single victorious stroke of life, all three, sin, guilt, death, are gone. The gift of our Master, Jesus Christ. Thank God. One thing my mom and dad discussed before he passed was that at their funerals, they wanted an invitation for people to follow Christ. I think it's kind of cool that that's one of the only things they discussed about this day. It tells you a lot about my dad. The weekend of the 4th of July, my parents watched the movie The Dilemma. My dad would be cracking up if he knew he was forcing me to use that movie for my big closer. In that movie, there was a line that so struck my dad that he changed his email signature to reflect it. Let me see if I can find it. Look, preachers should be more prepared than this, but. I saw this paper in his car when I came home from the hospital. Let me just read it. It says this: great moments are born from great opportunities. And then my dad, that was the line from the movie. My dad added this to it. He said, make this the day for your great opportunity. I believe that my dad would want this to be the day for your great opportunity. I think it's so fitting that it's his words that are the invitation to know Christ and to have a relationship with God. For some of you in this room who've never made the choice to follow Jesus, listen, I know some of you may have put it off. Some of you have not understood it, even the reason to do it. Maybe you've been too busy with your life. Let me just tell you, my dad's life and death are a testament to the man or woman you can become for your family and those around you if you will just surrender yourself to Christ. If you've not ever made Jesus your Lord and Savior, then make today the day for your great opportunity. Simply pray quietly to yourself and talk to God. Tell him how weird it is to talk to him, but that you want to know him like Doug knew him. Guess what? God's kind of already in love with you. He can't wait. He can't wait to, as the scripture says in a different translation of the Bible, remove the sting of death in your life like he did for my dad. I'll tell you one thing. I can't wait for the day when my dad puts his arms around me in heaven. It holds me close and I feel his whiskers on my cheek again. And his choked laugh and his cry against my chest as we stand beside Jesus, who will say, well done. I hope you'll be there with me. And we can laugh when Jesus gets up to preach. And my dad leans over and says, I wrote this one. You guys all stand with us and sing. We're going to have a congregational singing song. And I just want to say, if you've never done business with God, or maybe it's been a long time, maybe you've been just too busy, man, don't sing this song. Just talk with God. You don't have to have it right. You don't have to be perfect. You just need to tell him, I want to know you like Doug did. I know he'd want that for you. You may be seated. My nephew, Jonathan Wagner, is going to come up and read a poem now that he wrote for my grandpa. My dad.
Hey. Sometimes you try to see the light of day in the dark of night. We cry and get angry when all we have to do is just wait for the morning. When we lose someone we love, we hope they never had died, and because we're not meant for pain and loss. But instead, we hold on to the memories, like how your grandpa taught you how to whistle like a train with your hands, or sing songs about motorcycles and pickles. Or when you're leaving out at the door, just waiting for a big wet raspberry to hit you right on the cheek. But you see, it's not getting over the fact. It's holding on to the memories that keep you going.
In a moment, I'm going to pray and dismiss us. I just want to, look, I'm his son, so I got to tell you one more story. One of the things that I'd forgotten about till Chip reminded me of it was that growing up every single night around the dinner table, my dad would say, "Well, what's been the best part of your day?" And we'd go around and everybody would tell the best part of their day. And he'd go, "Sounds like everybody's had a great day." And he'd go on for a while, and we all knew he was waiting for us to ask him, "Tell us what was the best part of your day, Dad." And he would just go. Sometimes we'd let him sit and sweat. I mean, it'd be like 10 minutes. And he'd be like, "Yeah, you guys just, everybody had a great day. Sounds good." And finally we'd ask him. And he'd say, "I thought you'd never ask." Today, I hope when somebody asks you what the best part of your day was, that you will remember my dad. And you'll tell him, "I went to the best funeral service I've ever been to. And I remember one of the best men that I've ever met. I love him. And I'm torn up that my kids are never really going to know him. But I'm so glad for the time that I had with him. He was such a good dad." Let me pray. Father, I hope Dad's not annoying you at the dinner table. He sure is funny, though. God, I just thank you for his life. I thank you for all of the moments, all of the hugs. Thank you for the man that he was, that he became, the legacy that he has left. There's a lot to live up to. Jesus, I just pray that you would give our family and all of us who mourn and grieve your peace that surpasses all understanding. Jesus, I pray that you would come back soon and that you would end all of this turmoil and that you would redeem all of mankind once and for all. Come, Lord Jesus, come. I love you. Thanks for saving me. It's in your holy and powerful and precious name that I pray, Jesus. Amen.
Gentlemen, for such a lovely audience as usual. It's a pleasure being on the bill with Claude Luth and all the boys. Pauline and them cats. The boys gonna take a little bow right quick, so give them a nice hand. Stand up, Billy Kyle, right there. Come on there. Buddy Catlett right there. Tyree Glenn right here. Eddie Shue right there. Jewel Brown right here. Danny Barcelona right here. The old Satchmo right here. Thank you. Thank you. Before we say goodnight, let's go in this last one now, everybody. Da 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 da. And the old dolly, the old dolly, fighting that to heaven back when you been love. You look it swell, dolly. I can tell, dolly. You keep blowing. When you still don't stop, I feel the room sway and the band playing one of our old favorite tunes away back when. Oh yes, why? Take on rap ballads, Orlando and them till I free die. Down it up and go for baby, got you up and go for baby. I'm gonna go for things.